Remember what we're going to do. We're going to read some in Exodus 29. Then we're going to go to Leviticus 8, and then we'll probably go back to Exodus. So you might want to find a piece of paper or something to keep your place there. All right, Exodus 29 and verse 31. Excuse me. Thou shalt take the ram of the consecration and boil his flesh in the holy place. And Aaron and his sons shall eat the flesh of the ram and the bread that is in the basket by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And they shall eat those things wherewith the atonement was made, to consecrate and to sanctify them. But a stranger shall not eat thereof, because they are holy. All right. So let's just start there. This whole thing about consecration has related to the filling of their hands with the sacrifices. It is related to the first step was to take everything out of their hands, all of their identity, all their old occupation. The second thing was to fill their hands and to put the sacrifice into their hands. And that is particularly true of the last part, which is the peace offering. And it is the finishing touches on the consecration of the priest. And one thing you need to remember is that these things are not just Old Testament stories. We are not studying Old Testament history or Old Testament sacrifices. We are seeking by the Holy Spirit to have our eyes opened and our hearts brought to the place where we can live as New Testament priests, or where we can live the fulfillment of what these people only live the shadow. Now, to do that means we look at the shadow, but you only look at the shadow as an outline. You look at the shadow as a sketch. And then you look in the New Testament, and there you see the fulfillment of these things. And so it's important because nowadays there's almost no teaching on what it means to be a New Testament priest. There's no definition. There's no reality to it. Basically, for most people, being a New Testament priest simply is a title of which they can witness or do certain things, but it has nothing to do with the reality that's being set forth here that was meant to be a shadow of that which is true. And so we need the Holy Spirit, and we desire the Holy Spirit to take these dark shadows of things and to make Christ the reality in our lives and in our heart. So the priest began with taking the offering in hand, and you remember they cut it open, and in cutting it open they examined the parts. And I'll be alluding to this more and more, but it's very simply this. You can have a ram, you can have a lamb, you can have a bullock, you can have it in your field and look at it every day and not fulfill what the priest did, and that is to get on the inside, to look into the insides of Jesus. There are people in many denominations that copy the outside of Jesus. They pray for the sick. They feed the hungry. They go out on the streets. They help people. Many of those things are copying Jesus on the outside without knowing what's on the inside. And I'll tell you right now, if you know anything about many of the religions, the Dalai Lama does all those things. And many other, I mean, they help people and they try to pray for people and they want people healed and all this stuff. Gandhi did all that kind of stuff. You can look at the outside and conclude that, you know, it's all the same, but it's not the same because Jesus' inwards are different. And so there is this examination period, and that's just before the period we're going to talk about now, and that is the opening up, the examining, the study, and the contemplating. The contemplating. And we'll see that as we go, but that is so much more than devotions. It is the place of a priest. It is the place of his heart to know the one that is giving himself. And so, once this contemplation, once this examination is finished, once it has been seen for what it is and held up to the Lord, lifted up and held up for the Lord to see, then we are to sit down and eat the offering. So this is the first introduction of that in the scriptures that we just read. We not only offer it to God, but we sit down and we eat the offering. So when we offer the ram, and I'll tell you what, before I make that statement, let's go on over to Leviticus, keeping your place there in Exodus 29. Let's go to Leviticus 8. And let's read one verse here. Leviticus 8 and verse 31. And Moses said unto Aaron and to his sons, boil the flesh at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and there eat it with the bread that is in the basket of consecrations, as I commanded, saying, Aaron and his sons shall eat it. All right. So, having read that now, let's flip over to the second chapter of Galatians. Let's begin to try to make the leap into reality. And I mean reality as God always meant it. It was a wonderful system of shadows under the old covenant. But it was not God, it was not reality as God wanted it. It was not reality. It was shadow land. And he was deprived of people only giving him shadows and never giving him the real thing. And so here we see in Galatians 2:20, and I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Let's just stop right there. And I want to consider this thing, because when they as priests offered the lamb or the ram, when we as priests offered the ram, we identify with it. And here is the first, here is the place of identification. I am crucified with Christ. You were not there. You have not actually gone through that other than by identification. You went through it 2,000 years ago, and so you weren't around, so all you can do is lay hands on that. You can get your hands involved with it. You can bring it to the altar. You can see the death there, but in truth, you must, when you see Christ crucified, and in reality, you'll never look at Jesus on the cross and see you there. Not really, not really. I mean, you'll only understand you're there. You'll only believe you're there. You'll only have the Spirit bear witness that you're there, but not physically. You'll never see yourself there. You'll only see Jesus there. And so in these priests, when they killed the sacrifice, and when they put it to death, they were involved in the death, and they were involved in it, in the understanding, and in the contemplating of it, and in the examining of it. But all they could do was really lay hands on it and let the ram be killed. They were never killed. I mean, you are with Christ, but you aren't. Christ is crucified, and you are one with him. And he bears the whole thing. So there is this first step in this first place of identifying with it. I am crucified with Christ. I believe that, and that is That is a huge part of my walk and my faith, but that's not the end of it. And there are a lot of people who hear this message of Christ and Him crucified, and they say, oh yeah, yeah, 2,000 years ago, I believe that. I was crucified with Christ, and that's all it is an identification with something that happened a long time ago. But now is the next step. The priest took that ram, and again, in shadow land of only what we do in reality, they took that ram, they killed it, they opened it up, they examined it. They identified with it. But then they must sit down and eat it. Christ lives in me. Folks, Christ living in you is not an identification. Christ living in you is supposed to be a fact. They didn't play. We got several girls in here. When you were a little girl growing up, did you ever have tea parties? Did you ever, have little teacups or something like that, and you poured fake tea, and somebody, your parent or somebody, go, you go, I'm eating Jesus. I'm taking Him in. No, you're not. You're acting like you are. You're identifying like you are. But in fact, there comes a step after identification with His death that we take in and we eat of His life until His life is literally seen and manifested through us. That's the goal. These guys are just shadows. We're supposed to be the actual, real manifestation of this. Not lost in doctrinal land, but in a living reality. So, this ram, this life of God, or the life of the sacrifice, the life of the sacrifice is put inside of us. Put inside of us. Christ liveth in me. So they're now they are eating the thing that their hands were filled with. In other words, you are occupied. The priest's hands were now forever. Not just during this consecration time, folks. Their hands were forever. This consecration was only a small picture of what they would do the rest of their lives. Their hands were full of that, and now your being must be full of it. This is not just a commitment to preach the cross. This is not just an involvement with the message of Christ and Him crucified. This is an exchange. This is a communion. This is a feast whereby we take this ram of consecration, not just any ram, the ram that was slain, and we put it on the inside of us. So, again, first you fill your hands with it, you study it, you hold it up to God, you meditate on it, you examine it, you contemplate and going over the whole things, but then you eat it. And therefore, with the priest, it's not enough just to lift it up. They lifted it up. It was a heave offering. They lifted it up. And a lot of people lift up the crucified one. But I am here to tell you, the New Testament priest, it is not enough to just lift it up. It's not enough to lift up Christ and Him crucified. Most Christians want everybody else to die so that they can get what they want. God wants you to have His life in you, His self-giving nature. You know, Jesus saw nothing but people who had failed, and instead of rebuking them, instead of saying, you'll die, instead of saying, you're off, instead of saying, you're wrong, He said, I'll die. Anybody want to be like Jesus? Do you really? Then what it's going to be like is you're going to be like Him. You're going to give, and it won't be you giving yourself, it'll actually be him giving himself in you. Amen. I mean, that's what Paul said. He said, death worketh in me, but life in you. I bear about in my body the dying of the Lord Jesus. Folks, that's not dying just for, that's not an atoning death, that's a self-giving death. And so, there's enough people, there's enough Christians out there that want to crucify everybody else. There are too few, so small amount that would take the death, that would take the hurt and take all the blame that others might live. And who would know that? Jesus didn't go spread it around. Oh, I'm doing this all for you. No, they cursed him and they mocked him while he hung on that cross. He didn't justify himself. That is the life we're supposed to be eating. And the only thing, and I'm going to say this, you don't become a priest by not going through the consecration of the priesthood. And this is the final stage of what it means to truly be a priest of God. All right, so lifting up this message of Christ and Him crucified is a wonderful thing, and to have a place that we can do that and to have a commitment to do that. But living by it is so great to the Father, I can't put it into words. It's almost cruel to draw His attention by lifting it up and saying, here's the crucified one, here's the Lamb, and to draw His attention and then not sit down and commune with Him in it. Like, get His attention, then throw it over there and say, that's what He's like, so go over there and you eat it or whatever. Instead of saying, I lift Him up because I believe in His nature and I believe in His way. And I embrace that Father. That's why I lift Him up. And I lift Him up with my life. Any of you ever heard that song, I'm Gonna Love You With My Life? You know, instead of just love you with my, I love you with my emotions, gonna love you with my life. So here we are, we're lifting up the thing that pleases God the most. But the thing that pleases God the most must also become our life and our sustenance. And the priest's work was to offer and to eat. I was thinking about that. I'm sure it's probably here in my notes somehow. But I was thinking about that concept when it said that if you don't do this, if a priest doesn't do these things, doesn't eat the lamb, doesn't go through, if a priest doesn't do that, then he will die. And there's always two ways of looking at everything. There's the old covenant way, and there's the new covenant way. And the old covenant way is this: an angry God looking down on some priests saying, look, I make the rules here, and the rule is this. You will offer these things, and you will do it in this order, and you will eat this, and if you don't do it, you will die. Okay, there's that view, old covenant view. But then there's the new covenant view. And that is, you are priests. What I give you to eat is the offerings themselves. The table of showbread, eating from the offerings. And if you don't eat, you'll die. Anybody see a contrast of the two? One is, this is the food I have given you to live and to sustain you and to give you strength, and this will be the strength in you and the life in you and the ability in you. And if you don't do this, if you don't do it, you'll die because you're not eating of what I've given you. You'll just wither up and die. It's all in how you look at it. Old covenant view or new covenant view. Let's turn to the book of Joshua real quick. I want to bring in another. I tell you what, before we do that, I remember I had written down something that I wanted to read. So let me see if I can. here's where I just quoted that. I knew it was in these notes somewhere, but it was the very next thing. If the priest did not eat, they would die. But unlike Israel, the life that sustained the priests and gave them strength to carry out their tasks was Christ crucified. And if you don't eat him, you'll wither and die. No other subject was to be their meat and their bread. That was it. Isn't that interesting? You know, he didn't say, now, I'm going to give you corn on the cob. I mean, they ate of the altar. That's what they ate of. They ate of the altar. And so that's why I made that statement. No other subject was to be their meat and their bread. Well, you know, in Israel, you can say I'm one of the people of God and just chase after any old subject you want. You know, you can highlight evangelism, or you can highlight the family, or you can highlight this subject or that subject, but not the priest. This was the subject around which their lives was focused and of which sustained them as priests. It was the food they ate. And of course, they filled their hands with it, but they filled their bellies with it too. It's important. Their life was filled with it, and the focus of their daily activity was Christ crucified. They never left that, you know. They never left that. I don't know if they ever went on vacation. But I do know in the New Testament, in the New Covenant fulfillment of that, even if you go on vacation, you end up, it's still Christ in you. It's still Christ and Him crucified. It's still the Lamb of God. And you still find yourself in situations of ministering and of imparting and of, you know, even if you're, it doesn't matter how far away you go. You know, I mean, I've said stuff like that, and I haven't gone on, probably count the vacations I've gone on in my whole life on this hand right here. But you think, I got to get away from this. You know, first of all, we need to question what's going on in our head. Because if it's the nature of Christ, you'll never get away from it. If it's you trying to copy Christ, you do need to get away from it. Because it's not Christ, it's you. It's just you, and you'll wear yourself out. And the answer isn't to get away from it on a vacation. The answer is to get away from it as a theology and find Christ as life. That's all. It's very simple. And if Christ is living in you, He'll do all that, folks. You know, finding Christ as life is not an excuse not to do anything. Finding Christ as life is going the extra mile. It's being slapped twice. Am I right or wrong? Your life is only to go 1 mile. Your life is not to turn the other cheek. I got news for you. To really let Christ be life in you is asking for more things like that. More laying down your life, more involvement, more self-giving, more going the extra mile. But it's Jesus. The difference is it's Jesus, not you. We give up or we get tired or we don't like this. I don't like the constant, you know, self-giving. The Father does. It's who He is. Jesus does. It's who He is. The Holy Spirit does. It's who He is. So I don't condemn somebody that's quote unquote had enough, but I'm gonna say it like this, but I condemn the method if they're just gonna leave that instead of going to the Lord in a real way and getting hold of His life, because the whole goal is to lay hold of Christ, not to copy Him. That's why the priests were to eat of these offerings and not just copy how they died, and therefore we're going to die like he does. No. No. You take upon his life. You are transformed into that same self-giving image. So they first they offered the ram, which is Christ's life, to God, along with the bread, which is the bread of life, which was God's basis of acceptance and atonement and basis of relationship. Then what was acceptable to God, Christ crucified, became their inward parts, the way they lived, and the inward life and strength of their own existence. And that's what Paul meant when he said, yes, I am crucified with Christ. I identify with that. But just looking at Jesus on a cross, what he did for you, that's wonderful, but it's not enough to be a priest. Just standing before the cross and saying, my God, what a great God you are, is not enough. You must eat of that same sacrifice and let it work in you. Amen. That's the goal. That's the heart of the Lord. That's gathering unto him a kingdom of priests, those who are after his kind, those who have his heart, those who have embraced more than the Savior. They've seen the life of the Savior, what motivated the Savior, and it was lamb, and they've eaten of it. It's that simple. All right, so I wanted to make sure I read that before I got too far. Now, if you will, go with me to Joshua. And let's go to Joshua chapter 3. This is the story when Israel is about to cross the Jordan. They're going to be entering into the promised land. Joshua 3:14. And it came to pass when the people removed their tents to pass over the Jordan, and the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant before the people, and as they who bore the Ark were come unto the Jordan, and the feet of the priests who bore the Ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for the Jordan overflowed all its bank for the time banks all the time of harvest, that the waters which came down from above stood and rose up in one heap very far from the city Adam, that is beside Zarethan, and those that came down toward the Sea of the Arabah, even the Salt Sea, failed and were cut off, and the people passed over right against Jordan, or Jericho. And the priests who bore the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of the Jordan, and all the Israelites passed over on dry ground until all the people passed completely over the Jordan. The picture that we have here is a picture of part of what was the priest's specific food, or you could say it like this, the priest's part in the communion. And the priest part to eat was the breast and the shoulder. Okay. That was a shadow. If you're a New Testament priest, then this is your part. That is the breast and the shoulder. And so the priest shouldered this lifting up of Christ, just like the wave offering. They shouldered the ark and they put him on their own shoulders and they bore the weight of it and they bore the responsibility of it. And they carried him forth. And you see a little bit of this. It's not a full picture, but turn with me now to the Gospel of John, chapter 13. And it is a wonderful picture, and yet it's yet incomplete. John 13. And let's read verse 21 through 23. When Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in spirit and testified and said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you that one of you shall betray me." Then the disciples looked one on another, doubting of whom he spoke. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. And I just want to focus in on that part right there. That there is this reality that the same priest who shoulder the ark must also know his heart and not just his commands and his rules and his expectations. The shoulder and the breast. Not just to know his commands. Pharisees knew his commands. Pharisees kept his rules. Pharisees kept his commandments. But to know his heart, not just to shoulder what's supposed to be shouldered. And so there is this reality that we must feed on this. We must feed on it and not only lean on his breast like John did, mentioned here in verse 23. And it's a beautiful picture that John gives here. But it's incomplete because it's not a new covenant priest yet. It is a picture getting there, but it is before the cross. It is before the resurrection. It is before we have truly become priests. It is not the fulfillment. It is like every shadow that you ever see, it's pretty close in some ways, but it always falls short. Every shadow, every type, every picture, no matter how good it is, just like Joseph or somebody else, it always falls short in some area. And John falls short here because it's not just that we lean on it, but that we feed on this breast so that it becomes internal to us, not just hearing it. And it is good to hear his heart. Notice I didn't buffet that or say no to that. I said not just, because a true New Testament priest is not just leaning and listening. A true New Testament priest is taking that same heart and putting it on the inside of them. It's you could say it like this and be Old Testament. It's the command of the Lord that you do it this way. Or you could be you could see this in light of the new covenant, and you can say it is required. You could never represent him as priest if you don't have his heart in you, if you haven't partaken of him, if you're just busy, if you're just responsible, good, but that's not enough. And I'm going to tell you, I don't care how strong your shoulders are, if you don't have his heart in you, your shoulders will fail. You will get tired. You will want to quit. You have taken, it's as if you've gone through the consecration and you ate only of the shoulder. And you didn't eat of your part, because this is the priest's part. The other part, guess what? God consumed it. The fire came down and God consumed the other part. But we have a part. And good. Thank God he's given us responsibility in these areas. But folks, he didn't just lay the ark on your shoulders and say, shoulder this thing and be a good minister. Boy, that wouldn't have worked. He said, partake of the very one who gave himself. Don't just offer the sacrifice. Be a partaker of it. The priests at this point became one with the offering that they offered. They became one with the offering that they offered. And so, as I said, eating involves one primary thing: taking what is external to us and putting it on the inside. It's the only way, guys. It's the only way. It's the only way. Because if we don't, he's still external to us. His way, his nature, his forgiving spirit, his going the second mile spirit, his turning the other cheek. It's external to us, and it's nothing but torment to ask someone to do that. Can I get amen from somebody? And you see, the Lord Jesus didn't just come down here and command that. Then he died, and he said, take my flesh, eat my flesh, and drink my blood, and let the nature and the life that can fulfill it in the right spirit be in you. That's his deal. Many times in my life, when I find myself griping about something or falling short or not content or whatever, 9 times out of 10, and see, this is my barometer, this is about the only thing that can keep me on track. I look at myself and I say, that's not Jesus in you, and either you're backing off from Jesus or you haven't learned him in this way yet. You haven't brought him to the inside of you. You know, everybody wants to fix the world or fix the church. This is wrong and that's wrong. Folks, anybody can see what's wrong. Can I get amen? Anybody can see what's wrong. But you know, and this has been my experience over the years. I've had people at different times and rise up and say, okay, there's this wrong and this is wrong and that's wrong and this is wrong. And to a few of them, I actually turned it over to them. Some of you may remember, it's been a while back, but I turned it over and I said, I can go all the way back to Bolivar. And remember saying, look, I admit, I don't know everything. I don't know Jesus. I'm not a very good representative of him. I need to be changed into his image. Pray for me that God will change me. But in the meantime, if you can fix it and make everything run perfect, go ahead. You know what? I know one guy that I did that to and literally made him the pastor. Some of you probably don't remember this. Made him the pastor, and I got out of town. If you go talk to that man right now and you ask him if he ever wants to be a pastor again, he reaches up, feels them rope burns, and goes, no, sir. There came a day that he called me back and said, hey, this is yours. You're the one God called. Take this thing. You know? Well, I didn't want it, but God put me in it, so I will. But, you know, it's easy to see problems, folks. It's not easy to lay down your life and believe that life comes out of death and I'll die instead of try to rebuke everything. You know, it's a lot easier. You know, what did I say last week? We've become fruit inspectors, you know. So we just go around and look at everybody's little cart, you know, and go, well, you got this, you got that, and you got worms. Well, folks, you probably got worms too. You know, and if the deal is, if we think the answer is just pointing out the problems don't go by pointing out the law, folks. The law pointed out the problems, but never fixed anything. And many people that just want everything fixed are simply functioning under the law. Christ is the answer. Can anybody say amen to that? Amen. Christ really is the answer. I thought of a phrase the other day that, we're not really looking for the answer. We're looking for, oh gosh, it was just a good word. It was, it wasn't this word, but it was similar. We're looking for remedies. What? Quick fix or a remedy. We're looking for remedies. Or you could say we're looking for solutions. But it didn't say Christ is the remedy, and it didn't say Christ is the solution. It says Christ is the answer. And isn't it funny that Christ is the answer may, in God's mind, when he says that, may not mean that he'll fix them. That your problem with that is Christ as the answer. Now, see, here I go. I'm meddling again. I'm the only preacher called to deal with motives. You know, it's the worst position you could be in. Just talk about doctrine. Just make your doctrine correct. You know. But I know for a fact that if your motives are wrong, if your motives are impure, even if your stand for what's right is tainted. You know how I know that? God had to deal with me for years and years and years and is still dealing with me, and God forbid that he ever quit dealing with me. All right, so, and eating this thing, you're not putting this sacrifice into your mind. It's not a mental thing. That's where we mess up, because we talk about a renewed mind, so we assume that's a mental thing. It really is renewed in the spirit of your mind. It's not really just fixing your mind. It's not a mental thing. And the proof of that is, when you think you know it and you got it all settled, wait till you get in the next crisis and try to mentally pull everything up and see what a tool that is. You know, it's like standing in front of the great red dragon with a squirt gun. Okay, I rebuke you. I rebuke you. Greater is he that's in me. And he's kind of going, I don't think so. He doesn't appear to me to be very big in you. Because it's not greater is the knowledge of doctrine and facts that is in me than he that's in the world. It's greater is he that's in me. And when he becomes greater in you than you in you, does that make sense? That's a weird way of putting it, but then you're on the right track. So, in other words, Christ crucified, not just Christ crucified becomes a part of who you are, not just what you think. All right, the proof of that is, if somebody walked up and slapped you on one cheek, you have a split second to respond. Your mind, especially some of you, doesn't work that fast. It's like you'd get slapped and you go, hold it, I just need to think about this for a minute, let's see. He hit me on this cheek and I should, What's nature and what's life will kick in. Or something else might kick out, your foot kicking out to kick them back for slapping you. Or Christ will come forth, because Jesus loves his enemies. Now, he told us to, but he also gave us the life to be able to do it. So they slap you. And you know what? I've been on both sides of that thing. Man, have I ever. I've been on both sides of it where I couldn't get over the hump for anything to love my enemies, and tried and tried and couldn't figure out what's wrong. And I've also been on the side where it was just Christ, you just love, period, and it didn't matter, and it really, it seemed like it didn't matter how far they went or what they did. You loved your enemies, and you truly loved them. And they did things to hurt you, and you did things to help them. Well, who's going to really know that? Well, just the Father. Really, he's about the only one who will really know. So that if your motive is Son, the Son, Christ in you, if your motive is Son, all you can think about is that my Father get what he put in me, that I not just somehow offer him something and then he'll defend me. Wish I could think of that one. Spoke to me yesterday or the day before and said, we get in these circumstances, and I was thinking of David in the Psalms, and he cried out for an answer to show him the way of victory, to get out of the situation. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me and he said, cry out for the way. My words are not the correct ones as he spoke it to me. Cry out for the way of death, not life, not escape. Find the secret place of the Most High. Find the hidden wisdom of God. Well, like I said, I've been on both ends of it. So what it's done to me, actually, by being on both ends of it, is given me, it has given me a tremendous compassion for those who can't seem to forgive or love their enemies. It's also given me a commitment that I must preach this Lamb and I must live this Lamb or have this life in me and living through me. Because when it's all said and done, man, of all people, this is what I preach. And I don't preach it of my own. This is not a chosen subject. Let me tell you, if I was going to pick a subject that I was going to make the pinnacle of my life and would preach, this would not be it. I'm telling you, the way I was when I came out of Oak Cliff, I have a lot of gumption. I got a lot of Oak Cliff in me. I got a lot of Texan in me. I got a lot of angry orphan in me. I got enough stuff to rage and rip and tear. And that's a fact. That's a fact. You don't see it very often. I see it more than you do. But I've got some bad stuff in me. Incredibly bad. And, you know, you've heard me joke about the monster, you know. It's like keep it all pressed down and pushed down because if, you know, you open up, then it comes out and goes, you know, and attacks somebody. Well, it's not even cute like that. And that wasn't cute, but it looks cute compared to mine. I would never pick this message. I would never pick this. In fact, when I started out, 20 years old, I started out working for Kenneth Copeland. Did you know that? Worked directly with him, hand in hand, face to face. Doggone it, God got hold of me with the message of the cross. I would have a big old house and have a big old car and be famous and, you know, I would have been his little protege. But God got hold of me with the truth of the life of Christ and that the same life that gives itself we're supposed to eat. And that Christ, you know, I'm crucified with Christ also means that the life in me is the crucified Christ. The one that has a self-giving nature, that will go the extra mile, that will love enemies. Not love what they do, but you love them. Man, you love them. And you would die for them. And you know what? You probably will at their hands. You probably will die for them at their hands. And in your love, you open doors to them that are doors that they'll go through to get back at you. But the doors that you open is because you love them, because you care for them, because you want to protect them. But you're opening doors that's going to open the enemy to come on you. What kind of motivation is it that says, no, I won't do good to you because this is going to come back on me? That is a mind that has one thing on it. It's focused on self. That's all. There's no question about it. It's focused on self. And you go, you know, if your father is not going to be your shield, then you better protect yourself. Yes. And all the things that Jesus did, and we're, remember now, We're talking about the life of Christ. We're not talking about me, because I'm not that way. And you're not that way. Amen? Come on, we're not this way. Jesus is this way. And he really is the only one who's this way. That's why he didn't just make a whole bunch of little Christians. Not really. He made one body with one life. His life. Pretty cool. It's a great plan. It's a great plan. And it'll work for anybody. You see, it doesn't matter how bad you are or how messed up you are. All you got to do is yield to the life of Christ, and you got everything of his life. You know, I mean, I love it. I love it. But on the other hand, if I don't have his nature or his life within me, then all the things I'm going through is nothing but torment and hardship and agony. Man, life is hard without Jesus. Can I get amen on that one? It's hard without Jesus. I would not want to live in this world for two reasons. Because I see the ugliness of people without Jesus. And I see the ugliness of people with Jesus, but not living by his life. And to just live self-centered, selfishly, now, of course, would just be the worst, horrible fate that I could ever ask for. I'd rather be hunted like a dog. I'd rather live in caves and be driven out than to live like them. Anybody ever see the movie, Legend? Pardon? Legend. It's what's the guy that played Fresh Prince of Bel-Air? Will Smith. Yeah. What is it? I Am Legend. You know, you ever notice the people on the planet? You know, I was sitting with somebody and they said, "Man, it'd be terrible if it came to that." And I said, "It's already like that." No, I mean, it is. It's selfish and just trying to feed your own desires and, you know, just in happier in the darkness. And come on, man. I mean, I'm sitting there watching this going, "Man, isn't this horrible what we live in?" And they're going, "I hope it never turns to that." You know, just say something to hack these people off in this theater and they'll rise up and rip your flesh to shreds, you know. But we don't see with the eyes of the Lord. If it's not Christ, that's what we are. If it's not Jesus, we are, our nature is just bound to get its way. And it doesn't care who it hurts or how much it lies or whatever. It just doesn't. It doesn't. And is not even influenced by that. Can freely lie and not be smitten in heart. You know? Just kill me now. You know what I mean? I remember when we first moved up here to the Denton area. And out here on 380, there's a FEMA thing. But actually, there is something that is related to national security. It's an underground bunker thing, and it's one of the places, if I'm not mistaken, that the president could hide and stuff like that. And it's a big deal, and it's one of the places that the Russians would bomb during the Cold War, which many of you aren't fully aware of, but I was in the big middle of it, and this would be one of the places they bombed. And I remember somebody saying to me, "You know, during the Cold War, why don't we get out of town here, man? We're going to be destroyed." And I said, "You know what? I'd rather be killed right out with a nuclear bomb than to live in the mess that would be afterwards. You know, I wanted to build a house next door to the thing." You know? But somehow this survival thing, this place is going to be, you know, I'd rather live in nuclear winter where there's no food and we're fighting everybody for everything we can get and turning into animals. I don't think so. Just kill me now. Just kill me now. Well, forget bombing or all that kind of stuff. It's the same right now. You know, everybody turning to animals, fighting for what they can get, jealous of what you got and wanting this and not liking this and everything else, and very little love and very little, you know. And I tell you what, and we got a lot of young people here, folks. I'm just going to tell you, you're young and you need to pray your whole life for discernment. You do. Because you're going to judge by the flesh and you're going to judge by the outward. You need to spend your whole life praying for discernment. And many of you are motivated by fear. And you need to come to the place where you're motivated by love, where no matter what cost it costs you, that you will love people. And I'll tell you who you're supposed to love, the ungodly. I'll tell you who you're supposed to love, the undeserving. You know? And it's the one set of people we can't seem to love. But, so I'm telling you now, maybe you're not there yet. Maybe you're motivated by fear. But if I could almost say it like a prophecy, one day you will be motivated by love and things will be a lot different, a lot different. Even though your life in one sense will be more miserable outwardly, at least you got, and really I hate to say it, but I mean, it's okay because you love people. And you don't just love the people that love you. And you don't just love the people that are right. Jesus didn't just love the people that were right, you know. I mean, I think of him, I think of that prostitute washing his feet with the hair of her head and their tears, you know, and the Pharisee thinks in his heart, well, if he knew what manner of woman this was, he wouldn't allow this. He knew what manner of woman it was. And he didn't say, well, before you do any washing down there, you need to get saved and stop what you're doing. The prodigal son came back to repent, and the father never let him get it out. Just loved him. He loved him when he saw him. He loved him when he was gone. Now, that's hard to believe, but God is love. So it's not really that hard to believe. God is love. And I was talking with somebody in my office the other day, and I told him, I said, you know, I don't have much to offer as a human being. I said, about the only two things I've got is that I do my best to really, 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 really hear from the Lord and to deliver what I truly, with all my heart, believe is the Lord's word to you. And I try to do that consistently and all the time. And the other thing is, if everybody turns against you, if everybody hates you, and you are the worst thing in the eyes of all Christians or anybody, I will love you and I will stand by you no matter what. Regardless of how bad it takes my reputation down or whatever, I will love you no matter what. And that's about all I got. That's it. That's about all I got, you know. And in reality, that's not very much. But it's just about all, when I reach into this empty vessel, it's about all I can find in there. There are many great men of God, women of God. I'm not one of them. I'm not one of them. I'm not. I just love Jesus, and I love you, and I want to see his glory. I want to see these things that are shadows become life in us and to us. I want to see actual change. I don't want to see theological change. I don't want to see environment change because the environment is such. I want to see suns, not planets. Planets get caught in the gravity of the sun and everything. We're supposed to be sons of God. We're supposed to be making the gravity that holds people to the sun and keeps them circulating and centered on the sun, you know. And I want to see that in real life, under excruciatingly hard things, to see Christ come out of people somewhere, anywhere. And I believe this is where God put me, so here. So anyway, well, I don't know. Sorry I went off on stuff, but I just felt like the Holy Spirit told me to, so. Let's go ahead and take a break, and we'll come back in just a few minutes.